Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Reset Live Lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on financial management, we would be talking on capital budgeting, and under capital budgeting, we would be discussing discounted techniques. In the first half, we would be talking on two techniques, whereas in the remaining half of the lecture, we would be discussing on remaining techniques. And for this discussion, we have once again with us in our studios, Dr. Amarjeet Kaur. Dr. Amarjeet Kaur is a professor of accounting. She is a dean in a management school in one of the reputed management schools in the country. She has authored numerous books. Number of her articles have been published in reputed journals. She is a certified management accountant from USA. So let's welcome Dr. Amarjeet Kaur and let's try to understand those discounted techniques which we are going to cover. Hello ma'am, welcome to the discussion.
Hello Jitka, very good morning. A very good morning to listeners. We are going to talk about capital budgeting techniques and precisely discounted techniques, as Gitika just introduced about that. So friends, let's recall the discussion we had in the last module where we discuss about what are capital budgeting decisions. Capital budgeting decisions are primarily, you know, decisions which involve your expenditure of capital nature. We may call them as capex. In the business world, we have seen executive using word capex. So capex means capital expenditure. When we intend to spend on such projects which are going to give you benefit for more than 1 year, such projects, such proposals, such assets are known as capital expenditure projects. Right. So, capital expenditure basically expenditure on any capital good or capital, investment. Now, in the previous module in this regard, we talked about payback period, we talked about accounting rate of return, which are two of non-discounted methods of assessing whether to invest in a particular proposal or not. Today we will be talking about techniques which are known as discounted techniques, means the time value of money is incorporated while making the analysis for decision making. So let's have a discussion. Let's not concentrate on this slide. This is a wrong slide which has been shown. So We would be talking about the techniques first, and then we will talk about this decision rule. First of all, let's talk about one important technique, which is discounted payback method. In the previous module, we talked about payback method, right? In the payback method, we did not discount the cash flow. Now, discount cash flow means the cash flow which is expected out of a project in the next year, next to next year, in the future, right? It could be 10 years from now or 5 years from now. So, such cash flows are discounted at a rate of return which we consider is good for, consideration, which is good that we could make the profits out of the project we intend to invest. So basically discounting cash flows means you are considering risk involved in the project and you are considering the expected return you wish to have from the project. So you are accordingly you are going to discount the cash flows. So cash flows are discounted on a rate which is known as discount rate. And then we calculate payback method based on the discounted cash inflow value. For example, my cash flow is 10,000 next year expected, but I expect that there is some risk. I may have to discounted for at the rate of 12%, which is my expected rate of return. So my discounted cash flow would be less than 10,000, 9,900, 9,800, based on the rate of return I discount it at. So this is how we would be discounting the cash flows, and then thereafter we will do the cumulative cash flow analysis of those discounted value, and we get the discounted payback method. So this is how it is calculated when it comes out to be discounting cash flow. Now let's move to the next method, which is payback method, which is net present value. Net present value method is the most important method. Net present value means we would have discounted value of cash inflows and discounted value of cash outflows. So net present value means the difference of present value, which is discounted value. So present value and discounted value is one and the same thing. So difference between the discounted value of cash inflow and discounted value of cash outflow is known as net present value, right? So the decision rule for accepting a project is that if our NPV, net present value, is positive, we would be accepting the capital expenditure decision or proposal. If it is negative, we would be rejecting it. And there could be a possibility that net present value is zero. It means our discounted cash inflows are equal to discounted cash outflows. In that case, the business is indifferent whether to accept or reject. Then the decision would be taken on many other criterias, then only on the financial criteria, which is capital budget decision making, right? So have a look at the slide which was shown earlier. Now have a look at the slide. Here it clearly shows the decision rule for accepting net present value method or rejecting the proposal under net present value method. So if the NPV, which is cash inflows discounted value minus cash outflow discounted value, if it is positive, then accept. So this, since it seems like it is promising, the returns are higher than the outflow, so it seems to be a promising method, so we would be accepting it. And if they both are equal, so we are indifferent, we will decide on many other rules. And then if it is negative, it means our cash outflows are less, but inflows are less, then it is a negative net present value, which is not a very, very, good reason for anyone to accept it. So capital budgeting decisions having negative NPV, they are rejected. Moving forward. Now, the net present value analysis is based on two assumptions. What are those two assumptions? Number one, the amount of inflow which happens is happening in future, right? So it is assumed that all the cash inflows or outflows for future are based on the last day of the year. So they are received or paid at the end of the year. So only one amount, which is cash outflow or outlay on the current period, on the beginning of the project, happens at the beginning of the year. Rest of the inflows or outflows, they happen at the end and considered to be at the last day of the project. This is one assumption. The second assumption is this, that whatever we receive as cash inflow during the life of the project every year, we would be reinvesting the same amount at the rate of discount rate. So at which rate we are discounting our cash inflow, at the same rate we are expecting that during the life of the project, whatever is received as cash inflow, that amount is reinvested. So these are the two important your assumptions. Now let's talk about what are the expected cash inflows and what are the expected cash outflows. So expected cash inflow, the most important one is that we receive revenue. The revenue would be incremental revenue. So incremental revenue means what? Incremental revenue means the revenue which we are going to get out of this project into consideration. So it means the previous revenues which are received by the company by the business, they are not considered, they are independent. We are concerned about how much increase in the revenue would happen in total of the company because of this particular project. So only that particular revenue, which would be known as incremental revenue, would be considered. Then we would be seeing what is the salvage value. Once the project would be over, the proposal would be over, or the machine is exhausted, the useful life of the machine, machinery, plant, etc. is over, then we are able to sell it. So if we are able to sell it and we are able to fetch some amount, that is what is known as salvage value, right? So that salvage value is another cash inflow during the life of the project. Then working capital is something which may get released. If the project has specific need of increased working capital in the beginning, so once the project is over, the life of the project is exhausted, we may not need the same amount of working capital in future for the remaining proposals. So that's what it is. The last thing could be reduction in cost. So reduction in cost of is independent option. Either, you know, the project would either save you some cost or would give you some additional revenue. So both are the scenarios under capital budgeting decision, and this is another revenue, this is another inflow of cash. Now let's talk about cash outflows. And the cash outflow, first most important, is that we are going to spend, we are going to pay for the cost of the project itself. Proposal itself, machinery, it could be plant, machinery, anything, land, building. So this is known as initial investment. So initial investment is the primarily the first thing which we would be spending, is considered as cash outflow. So this is not going to be happening at the end of the year. The initial cash outflow, as I just discussed a minute ago, would be considered as happening in the beginning of the year. Right, rest of the amount, either inflow or outflow, are assumed. This is the assumption in the net present value. They are assumed to be happening at the last day of every year in future. Okay, the next thing is incremental cash operating cost. Incremental operating cost is your outflow. So this is the cost which you are going to spend because you are accepting this proposal. Otherwise, it is not there. So we compare incremental revenue. Revenue is your inflow and incremental outflow is your expenditure. So we compare both of them and we take net revenue if the revenue is more, or net cost if the cost is more. So incremental cost is another outflow. Then after that, we may spend on repair and maintenance of during the life of the project. It could be after 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, any year. So even that is also considered as one important outflow. And lastly, you may require additional working capital, and whatever you spend on working capital is known as outflow for the project. So we have outflows and we have inflows. Now why do we need to discount? As I just said, net present value is the difference between discounted cash inflows and discounted cash outflows. We need to discount. Why? Because your inflow, certain inflows are happening today. Certain your outflows are happening, the majority of the outflows are happening today. Right, inflow may happen today, may happen tomorrow, day after. In most of the projects, inflows, they do not happen today. Inflows are always in future, and outflow is, maximum outflow is today. As a conventional project, there could be some project where some outflow is today and some outflow is in future, but inflows are 99% in future only. So you are not, if you are going to get inflow and outflow both today, then you need not to discount. Then there is no question of bringing the inflows at par with the outflow. So we discount because we want to incorporate time value of money, because money which you will receive a year after, a 2 year after, may not have the same purchasing power, right? Will have reduced purchasing power. So that is why we apply time value money concept and we do discount the receipts received in future. So I hope you could get the reason why we discount them, because they are not happening at the same time period. With this, now let's talk about that, how do we choose the discount rate? Discount rate is basically the average cost of capital for the business in question. So this cost of capital varies from businesses to one business to another business. So discount rate is also known as required rate of return, because this is the rate at which the funds have been acquired at by the business. So average rate of acquiring funds is basically cost of capital, and based on that cost of capital, we discount our inflows which we receive in future. Now let's take this case to understand how net present value work. So this, as per this case, master company has offered a 5-year contract to provide component parts for a large manufacturer. So cost and revenue information is there. Cost of special equipment 1,60,000. Working capital required is 1 lakh. Relining equipment in 3 years is 30,000. So it means this is additional repair cost or maintenance cost. So you want to reline the equipment. Salvage value of the equipment after 5 years. So it means life of the project is 5 years. So 5,000 would be the amount you would be able to recover. Annual cash revenue and cost is given. So they are incremental. Sales revenue from parts is 7,50,000. Cost of the parts sold is 4 lakhs. Salaries and shipping etc. is 2,70,000. It means my incremental, if you look at the information, it says at the end of 5 years the working capital will be released and may be used elsewhere by the company. So master company uses a discount rate of 10%. Should the contract be accepted or not? So discount rate is given to you. So let's see first of all the annual net cash inflow from the operations. So what is the sales revenue? Sales revenue, if you remember from the data given, was 7,50,000, out of which we would be subtracting incremental cost for the parts sold and incremental salaries and shipping etc. 270. So annual net cash inflow would be 80,000. So this is annual. It means every year up to the life of the project, which is 5 years, the company would be receiving this 80,000 rupees, right? So how do we actually solve the problem or the capital expenditure issues while using net present value? And believe me, net present value is the most widely used technique. So I hope you are with me and you are able to get what we are discussing. So net present value method, we would preferably, we should have this kind of table. So at the first, we are showing the details, first column. Second column, we are showing years, which is life, N, you know. Then in the third column, we are showing cash flows. Cash flows means both inflows and outflows. Next column, we are showing the discount factor, which is also known as present value factor, for the given discount rate, which is 10% in this case. And then we multiply the cash flows with the discount factor and we get present value. So present value is the last column where we are showing it in. So let's take in the annual net cash inflow every year for 80,000 is received. So from 1 to 5 years, so it becomes annuity, because if you are receiving every year, it is an annuity. If I hope you remember, we discussed in the time value money concept that annuity is is a nature of cash inflow or outflow of this. When the amount is same, it happens at the same interval and for the known period. So 80,000 is the amount. So amount is same. It is happening every year. Means the gap between the receipt is same. So 12 months, and we know we will receive it for 5 years. So that's how it becomes an annuity. So we will be referring to the annuity factor, annuity table. So which is in most of the books, it is the fourth table in order. So the factor at the rate of 10%, the corresponding factor is found. I would recommend you all to practice a lot on using of table. So 3.791 is the discount factor at the rate of 10%. So if we multiply 80,000 with 3.791, we get the present value 3,03,280. So salvage value is going to be received in fifth year. So 5,000 is there as a receipt, is a cash inflow. Now we would be using the discount table for 1 rupee. So there is a difference between the discount factor. The first discount factor was annuity factor, and this is a factor for 1 rupee. And 1 rupee discount factor is always less than 1. So this is important. So if you multiply 5,000 with 0.621, it gives you 3,105. Working capital, as it was given in the case, that it will be released. So 1 lakh was the initial working capital. So it will be received back in the fifth year. So fifth year discount factor is same, 0.621. So the product of 1 lakh multiplied by 0.621 comes out to be 62,100. Now the initial investment, which is at zero period, now means zero, you can write it zero as well. So 1,60,000 is in bracket, it is outflow. So bracket denotes outflow, right? So 1,60,000 multiplied by 1, where do we get this 1 as a discount factor? So discount factor for today is always 1, kindly remember it. Discount factor for current period today is always 1. So it means my actual expenditure today is 1,60,000 only. Working capital which I need today, which is 0, is 1 lakh. So I will discount it for today's factor, which is 1. So 1 lakh is in bracket. It is the total expenditure. Now after that, you are supposed to spend on relining in the third year, right? So I hope you remember that. So in the third year, when you are realigning, 30,000 is going out. So 30,000 into the discount factor for 3 years is 0.751. So the product of 30,000 and 0.751 comes out to be 22,530. Now, if you sum up these first three values, which are cash inflows, and if you are sum up these last three values, which is cash outflow, and subtract the cash outflow, these three values in bracket, from the sum of these three values in the beginning, which is cash inflow, the difference is net present value, which is 85,950, right? So it means we can accept the project because net present value is positive. So this is how we accept or reject the proposal under net present value. Let's take a quick small caselet to reinforce the concept of net present value, because it is very, very important. So many associates has offered a 4-year contract to supply the computing requirement for a local bank. The cost of computer equipment is 2,50,000. Working capital requirement is 20,000. Upgrading of equipment in 2 years is 90,000. And salvage value of equipment in 4 years is 10,000. Annual net cash inflow is 1,20,000, right? So the working capital is released at the end of the contract, so it becomes inflow. So many associates requires a rate of return at the rate 14%. Okay, so equipment, the initial investment 250, working capital is also given. So how we would solve the question? So we will solve the question like this. Your answer would be 28,230 net present value. How did we do? Now means zero period, we are spending 2,50,000. Discount factor would be 1, as I just solved in the previous case as well. So the present value would be 2,50,000 in bracket. Working capital needed is 20,000 in bracket. So at the rate of 14%, the discount, it doesn't matter what is the rate, because as of date, the discount factor would be always 1. So irrespective it is 14 or 18, this would remain same, right? So the present value is 20,000 in minus, it means outflow. So annual net cash inflow for 1 to 4 years is 1,20,000. If we take the discount factor from a table at the rate of where we look at the in the column at the rate 14%, so this is the entry table, 2.914 for 4 years, 14%, the corresponding value is 2.914, right? So you multiply 2.941 with 1,20,000, it gives you 3,49,680. So this is your cash inflow. Then upgrading of equipment. Upgrading of equipment is 90,000 in the second year. So if we take the discount factor from year second and the rate 14% and you multiply it, it comes out to be 69,210. Salvage value of the equipment is 10,000, which would be inflow in the fourth year. So N4, rate 14%, the discount factor would be 592.592. So the product of 10,000 into 0.592 is 5920. The last thing is working capital is released in the year 4 and it is 20,000. So 20,000 multiplied by 0.592 gives you 11,840. So if you add up these two values in bracket, three values, 69,000 as well, and you add up these positive three values, so you subtract negative values from the positive values, which is cash inflows are 349,5920, 11,840, subtract the outflow which are shown in bracket, the net difference is 28,230, which is your answer, which is your net present value, right? So now the last thing I want to talk about is evaluation of time value, net present value concept. The evaluation of net present value concept is shown to you in this slide. Have a look and then we will discuss. The first thing is net present value considers time value money concept. Discounting and compounding are two important techniques of time value money, and we have used discounting techniques in net present value. So time value money concept is very well considered in the net present value concept. The second is net present value considers the total benefit of during the life of the project. It's unlike in payback method where we would be considering only the amount up to the recovery of the initial investment. Whatever we received after the recovery of initial investment is not considered. So but net present value is a very advanced technique in comparison to payback method, and it considers your total receipts during the life of the project. Then there's one important thing is we can change the discount rate the way we want as per the need. It need not to be discounted. See, for example, in the last case we were discounting at 14%. We need not to discount at 14% in all the years. It could be possibility that the first year we are discounting at 14% because that was the expected discount rate. The next year it has gone up or gone down. So we can discount at 15% or 13%. So change in discount rate for the purpose of discounting in different year is quite possible, right? And this is the most useful technique in mutual exclusive projects. So this is one important point, and definitely it considers the objective of financial management, which is wealth maximization. So the objective of shareholders' wealth maximization is very well considered. Why? Because we are considering the absolute increase in terms of cash. Cash inflows are over or more than the cash outflow, only then we have net present value in positive terms. And we would be accepting only such projects which have positive net present value, means we are going to ensure the increase in the or maximization in shareholders' wealth. Now, every coin has two sides. So, net present value also has limitations. So, what are the limitations? The first important limitation is or disadvantage is that it doesn't, it is a very, very difficult technique in calculations when it comes to calculations. So, a very difficult technique to understand and to calculate. This is first thing. Second is calculation of discount rate is very difficult. Discount rate is cost of capital, which is not a handy thing available. It means before you decide to apply net present value, you need to find out the cost of capital for the business. So that is another important limitation to be considered before deciding to choose to apply this method. Then another thing is that this technique, net present value technique, it ignores the initial size of the investment. For example, the net present value could be 50,000 for a project which has initial investment of 10 lakhs and could be 50,000 also for a project which has an initial investment of 1 crore. So, project A has initial investment of 10 lakhs, project B has an initial investment of 1 crore and both are giving you the same net present value, right? If someone doesn't consider the net initial investment, you will say project A and project B are equally important and good, but which is actually not true. This is another important consideration before we decide to apply net present value. Hope you could understand the most important capital budgeting technique of net present value. Thank you so very much for being watching. Thank you. A very good afternoon to you all and welcome back. This is the second module on discounted capital budgeting techniques. We would be talking about internal rate of return and profitability index, two important techniques which are known as important discounted capital budgeting techniques. So, first of all, we will talk about internal rate of return. Internal rate of return is basically rate of return is an important method of discounted capital budgeting. It's a rate of return method to rank competing investment projects. So what is the rule for accepting or rejecting under IRR? The higher the internal rate of return, the more desirable the project is, right? So what does it mean? It means we need to calculate, first of all, two things. We need to calculate the internal rate of return for the project in question, and we need to calculate the cost of capital for the business, two things. And we would be comparing cost of capital with internal rate of return. And if our internal rate of return is higher than the cost of capital, then we accept the project. If it is lower, then we reject it. So for the purpose of calculation internal rate of return, there are two different business situations. One is when your cash inflows are in the form of an annuity. So we call them as even cash inflows, right? And second is we call them as mixed stream, or known as uneven cash inflows. So we have to see accordingly that either this is a situation of even cash inflows or it is a situation of uneven cash inflows. Let's talk about the first one, which is easy, even cash inflows. So how do we calculate internal rate of return? Mind you, this is a very difficult technique, in comparison to other techniques of capital budgeting, discounted technique of capital budgeting, right? So there are many steps. I have listed down those steps for you. So steps in IRR when cash flows is an annuity. So calculate payback period of the proposed investment. We have been given, inflows every year. Say for example, if I am receiving 20,000 every year, so I would be calculating payback period. My initial investment is, for example, 1 lakh, and the life of the project is 10 years. So 20,000 every year I am receiving. So my payback period is 5 years, because 20,000, if we divide 1 lakh with 20,000, it comes out to be 5. So 5 would be my payback period. So that is the first step. The second step is we would be referring to entry table and find out two discount factors. One is which is higher, another is lower than the PB, payback period of our given N. So considering what is the N is very, very important. So first step we decided is that we have to have our payback period. And once the payback period is in hand, the next thing is that we would be referring to the annuity table. Annuity table, and then refer to row row and the column corresponding to your N and corresponding to the rate of return. You would be observing which is the value, which is the rate, return given or discount factor given, which is close to the PB you chose. So you calculated one PB. For example, your PB was, payback period was 3, right? And what is the next thing? You are going to go to empty table and you will be referring to N10, because your N is 10. Your given case N is 10. It could be 5, it could be 7. So refer to N10, go across the row, find out the value which is very, very close to the payback period you calculated in the step 1. Now you do not have to find out only one value. From that table, you would be finding out two values, which is discount factor values. One is smaller than the payback period, another is higher than the payback period. So two values of discount factor are used from the table, which is entry table. One is smaller and another is higher than the PB payback period. Now what would be next step? Now you have two values in hand. So after that, this we would be now going to the top of the table where we have rate of return given. So R is given, right? So R is the rate of return, internal rate of return for the time being. It's not the exact one. So two values, two discount factors were noted down in the previous step. Now we would be noting down the corresponding value of R for both the discount factors. It means we would have two R as well. So when we refer to R at the top of the table, you have two R, which are generally, you know, immediately the next value. For example, one is 18, another is 19. One is 12, another is 13. So we have two internal rate of returns noted down by this time in your hand. And now after this, we would be interpolating. So what is interpolating? Interpolating is a technique, is a mathematical technique where we would be using these two factors and PB factor, and we would be finding out the exact value of R, internal rate of return. Once you have those two R's, internal rate of return, from the top of the table, so it means you know the approximate value of the IIR, internal rate of return. So you know the answer almost, that my answer lies between 18 and 19, 17 and 18, 15 and 16, those two rate of return. So why we are interpolating? We do not have to make an approximate value. We have to find out very exact value for IRR. That's why we need to make interpolation. Otherwise, you know, your answer lies between 17 to 18. My answer lies between 12 to 13. Because you have already got those two rate of returns, which are internal rate of returns. Internal rate of return of a project means the rate at which my discounted cash inflows would be equal to discounted cash outflow. This is what internal rate of return. It means if my internal rate of return is, if my cash inflows which are discounted are equal to my cash outflow which are also discounted, if they are equal means my net present value is zero. I hope you remember few minutes ago we discussed net present value is the difference between discounted cash inflow and discounted cash outflow. If they both are equal means my net present value becomes zero. So internal rate of return is a point, you know, where we discount. So it's a rate of return at which we discount cash inflow and outflow and we get NPV zero, right? It means if I am an owner of a business, how does it make a difference? How would I use IRR to decide? It means this project would tell you that internal rate of return for this project where your inflows are equal to outflow is for example 19%. So R is 19% and the cost of my capital, which is also denoted as K, small k, letter English letter K. So if my cost of capital is 12%, now I have to compare R, which is 18%, with K, 12%. It means my R, which is internal rate of return, is higher than K, I should be accepting the project. So decision rule is if R is higher than K, accept the proposal. If it is lower than the K, then reject it. So R and K both are important. But when it comes to understanding or interpreting this conclusion or interpreting this result of the calculation, this internal rate of return is easily understood by the owners, by the managers. Why? Because they know that project is giving me this much percent higher return than my cost of capital. For example, 18R and 12K. It means 6% higher return on my proposal is expected. So this is what the benefit of R is this. So this is the example when we have even streams of cash inflow. What do we do when we have uneven stream of cash inflows? So in that case, we call them as mixed stream of cash inflow. And this is how we calculate. And this is more tedious than the even cash inflow. So let's have a look at the slide. We would be using few steps to calculate IRR in case of mixed stream. The first step is that we would be calculating average annual cash inflow to get fake annuity. So, in case of even cash inflow, there was an actual a normal annuity in the case in the question, right? 20,000 every year means that was an annuity in by choice given. But in case we are getting 18,000 first year, 20,000 second year, 21,000 third year, 24,000 fourth year, and so on, it means my cash inflows every year I receive are different. They are not same. So this is what is known as mixed stream cash flows. So first step is to calculate fake annuity. So that how do we calculate? We will be summing up all the cash inflows which are expected, right? And we will divide it by the N, that is life of the project. And this gives you cash annuity of the cash inflow, right? The first step. Now, after this, we would be calculating fake payback period. In the first step, we calculated fake annuity because this is not the actual. So, fake annuity is very much as average inflows, right? Now, the second step is we calculate fake payback period. In the fake PB, what do? We take the initial investment and we divide it with the fake annuity. So, the factor which you get is known as fake PB. So, in the last example, in the last case, this PB payback period was actual, but this time it is not actual, this is a average PB, so which we call it as in the books, you will find it as fake PB, payback period. So what is the next step? Next step is that we would be referring to annuity table and we will be referring to the annuity table and we would be finding out, we will be referring to N and we will be referring to R, corresponding to the factor which is close to the PB you calculated in the previous step. Say for example, if you have invested 36,000 initial investment, the life of the project is 5 years and you are expecting to get 12,000, right? First year, second year 11,000, fourth year 14,000, 13,000. So your fake PB comes out to be 12,000 and fake annuity comes out to be 12,000 and fake PB comes out to be 36,000 divided by 12, so 3. So my fake PB is 3. So what is next step? I have to refer to annuity table and have to find out, you know, for the N5. So I would be referring to the row 5 and would see which is the discount factor which is very much close to 3. It could be 3.0097, it could be 3.0067, right? So the factor which is closest to the discount factor or the PB factor we calculated in the previous step is noted down. So once you note down this factor, then what is the next step? Next step is that we have to adjust the factor which we calculated, which we just found from the table. How do we do the adjustment? Say for example, your initial investment was 11,000 in the case, second year it was more and third year more. So we compare the initial investment with the average annuity. Average annuity was 12,000. My initial investment was low. So if my initial investment are lower than the annuity, we will reduce the rate R, because you have noted down the corresponding R as per the fake PB, right? So we will reduce down the R by few points, maybe 1 point, maybe 2 point, depending upon how much is the difference of average annuity you calculated and the initial inflow, right? If initial inflows are more than the average annuity you calculated, we will be increasing the R calculated in the previous step. So this adjustment will give you R, which is required rate of return. This is the rough approximation of the internal rate of return, but this is not the answer. Now what do we do? With the help of this R, we would be discounting all the cash inflows which we have in actual. So if, for example, first year 11,000, we will be referring to the table at the rate of R which we calculated. We will note down the factor for that R and we will multiply the factor with the cash inflow, and that would be our present value for that individual cash inflow. We will be repeating this step for all the cash inflows we have. So all cash inflows are discounted with the help of R. So you note down the discount factor for every year, R remains same, right? But year is different, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 year. And because the year is different, for every year, the discount factor would be different. So we multiply discount factor with your cash inflow, and the product of this two is your present value. So we will make the total present value, we will subtract the cash outflow. If our difference NPV is zero, the difference of discounted cash inflow and discounted cash outflow is zero, then this is good, it's a good luck for us, because that's what we are looking for. So we are looking for NPV zero basically, because I just mentioned few minutes ago that IRR is basically where net present value is equal to zero, right? So the target is, the objective is to find out net present value as zero. But let's say you are not able, you discounted it at the rate of 17%. So 17% for different N, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, your rate was, your discount factor was different, and you ended up 120 as a positive net present value, right? So what to do now? Now you need to have another, you know, calculation with the same, all the steps to be repeated, all the last two steps to be repeated. It means now we would be discounting at a different rate so that our net present value comes out to be negative. So which means if my previous value was positive, I would be discounting at a higher rate now. If you discounted earlier, for example, earlier you discounted at 17% and your value was 120 as positive value, and now you are looking for one negative value. So what do you need to do is, you need to increase the discount rate, say 18%, and now you discount it again, so repeat the step, and if you end up with the negative value, it's good luck for you. If you do not, then you need to go further below. You need to discount it at the another discount factor. So now let's assume you got a negative value at 18%. So one positive value, let's assume 120 at 17%, and say 87 as a negative value minus 87. You got it in the second case when you discounted second time. So now you have two values, NPV values, one NPV positive, one NPV negative. So best would have been that NPV is zero. That's what we have to calculate, what we have to reach to. But if we are not able to reach to that in the first attempt, we would have either a positive value or a negative value in the first attempt. So we need to get the reverse of it. If my first value was positive, I need to get the second value as negative. If my first value was negative, I need to get second value as positive, right? So once you have one positive NPV and one negative NPV, then last step is that we would be interpolating. Interpolating is a mathematical technique where R plus minus is taken, and then we solve equation PV minus discount factor for R you have taken, divided by the difference of discount factor for small r and the higher r. So you have two r's there. So that's how we interpolate and we solve r for the given situation where mixed streams are there, right? So this is the situation where streams are mixed or uneven. I hope you could gather it. It is quite a difficult technique, I would certainly accept and say. Let's see the merits and demerits of this technique. The first thing is that have a look at the merits and demerits. This considers time value money concept, very much like net present value technique. We can actually, we are also discounting all the cash inflows. So this is an important factor to be considered, that IRR is very much like NPV method, considers time value money concept, so our results are reliable. Then the second thing is, it considers total benefit. Total benefits received throughout the life of the project are discounted. It's not that we are discounting only the initial cash inflows, or we are discounting only up to the recovery of the payback period. No, we are discounting total amount of cash inflows received throughout the life of the project. So that is another important merit. The next thing is, as I said, it is a very, very easy technique to understand. Owners can, because they know how much is cost of their capital they are using, cost of the funds they are using. So once they know this is the return exclusively pertaining to the project in question, so they know this is the expected rate of return from the project, not from the total business, right? That's the difference. So I know as an owner, as a manager, that this is the rate of return expected from my project and this is my cost of capital. So I am able to take decision very effectively because of this particular proposition. Then since in IRR we calculate, of course we calculate more than one or two IRR in case of mixed stream, we need not to discount inflows at different discount rates as in case of NPV we can do, right? Then the last is, this IRR technique is also very, very useful when it comes to maximization of shareholders' wealth. Why and how? Because we are not going to accept any project which has internal rate of return less than my cost of capital. We would be accepting only those projects which has my internal rate of return which is more than my cost of capital. And if my internal rate of return is higher than my cost of capital, means my shareholders' wealth is going to go up. This is going to add to my shareholders' wealth. So what are the limitations of the IRR? The first limitation, which major limitation, is this, that this is a very tedious, concept when it comes to calculation. So very tedious calculations are involved in IRR. We may have to solve IRR 4 times, 5 times, 6 times if we are not adjusting at the right value. So you remember, we were required to adjust the internal rate of return, which was rough approximate in approximation in third step. So that is a major limitation. It confuses for times because it produces multiple rates, 16, 17, 18, 19, and then it confuses to the user of that which particular rate is the most reliable. Though if someone is an expert, knows the rate which equates my NPV which equates my internal cash inflows with external with my outflows, cash outflows, that is what the rate is, the reliable one. But nevertheless, it does produces many rate of returns, which becomes the limitation, right? So let's move to the next technique, profitability index. Now the profitability index is, as I said, is another important discounting technique. There are two ways to calculate profitability index. In few books, you will find profitability index is an absolute ratio of discounted cash inflow with discounted cash outflow, right? So it means if your discounted cash inflows are 1 lakh and if my discounted cash outflows are 50,000, so discounted cash inflow 1 lakh divided by discounted cash outflow 50,000, so my answer becomes 2. So in that case, we see if my profitability, so we call it this as PI, profitability index. So if my profitability index is greater than X1, this is acceptable. Greater than 1 means 1.5, 1.2. The higher it is, the good for me as a businessman. So it means my cash inflows are those many times higher than my outflow. Because if you just look at the formula I just said, is cash discounted value of cash inflow is divided by discounted value of cash outflow. So this is also a very good technique which is useful in ranking situations. But there are books which do use some other way. So especially foreign author books, you may come across profitability index is calculated as a percentage by taking net present value, which means this, first you discount your inflows, take the discounted value of cash outflow, subtract discounted cash outflow from the discounted cash inflow. The difference is your net present value, and this net present value is divided by discounted cash inflow, and the answer you get is profitability index. So net PV divided by discounted cash inflow. So this is another way of calculating your profitability index. So profitability index is an important and a little improved version of NPV. This could be used, you know, if you remember, one limitation of NPV was this, that this can give us, NPV can give us misleading results if initial investments are different. This profitability index considers that limitation into consideration and takes this into consideration and gives us reliable results even if the initial investment is different. So I hope you could gather all the techniques which are known as discounted capital budgeting techniques very well. Thank you for watching this show.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much for giving us a productive session. And dear friends, we would love to have your feedback. Do write to us at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again soon and would be talking on different and another topic. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.